Yeah, so Brandon Woody's Upendo. Upendo means love in Swahili. I don't speak that language. When I was, as soon as I dropped out of college, I had moved back to Baltimore and started a band. And one of the most central things about my music was love and bringing different types of groups, socioeconomics and races and cultures together. And I was like, man, I want it to be called love because that's what the music is about, but I didn't want it to be just called love. I was like,
man, what is love?
So I searched it up. I searched, you know, love up in some different languages, yeah. And I was like, oh shit, Upendo just kind of has like a cool ring to it, you know.
Not for nothing though, Brandon Woody's love.
I don't know.
It's kind of hard.
Yeah. that's what it is. Yeah, that's what it is.
Well, Brandon Woody, welcome to Not 97.
Thank you. Thank you, man.
Welcome to New York.
Yes, sir.
Before we fully get into it, if you don't mind giving a quick introduction of who you are and where you come from, what you do.
Yeah, so I'm from Baltimore, Maryland. I'm 25 years old. When I was about 6-7 years old, I started getting into music, played the drums first and sucked at it, picked up a trumpet the next year. And my mom really invested into, you know, just getting me into all of these different programs all around the city and outside of the city. Really fell in love with music. By the time I got to middle school, I met Troy, one of my biggest, you know, partners in music. And we went to Baltimore School for the Arts together, which is like kind of like the, you know, big art school in my city in Baltimore. Yeah. And it just got serious, man. Every year it got more serious. And while I was in high school, I started writing my own music. I felt like I didn't always have the opportunities to play jazz or black music in high school because my high school was so focused. And this isn't a bad thing, but, you know, there was a lack thereof, like, some of the music that I wanted to learn about, more about. We were more focused on symphonic music and Eurocentric music, which was cool. It's like, man, I'm getting amazing technique and just really learning how to play the trumpet, which I need to be doing. So that was fine. But then I, you know, went to college. I got a full scholarship to the Brubeck Institute in Cali, started studying with Ambrose Akinmusiri and Stefan Harris. And that was amazing because I had to bring in compositions every fucking week. Like, if I didn't bring in, that was the homework. Yeah. We didn't have, when I was in college, it wasn't like a regular, you know, whatever, university and humanities and all that shit. No, we had fucking 4-hour rehearsals every day. We had a private lesson every week. We had composition class every week. And we just had to bring in music. I love that, you know, right after I was 18 years old, I wanted to go as far as I could. So I got full scholarships everywhere in all of the colleges I applied to. But I was like, man, this is the farthest from Baltimore. Let me fucking go as far as I can. So I got out there, and guess what happened? I was like, I didn't have anything connected to me from my past life, and I was able to, like, learn. I think, you know, once we leave our homes, especially after 18, once we're grown up, it's like, man, who am I without, you know, maybe all of the clutches or all of the, you know, home things, my friends and family? No, who am I just by myself? So I was like, man, this thing that I was doing back then and there, man, that may have been more like about my surroundings and not my personal self. So once I got there, it's like I fell more in love with myself, started writing more music. And some of the music that I was writing out in Cali, you know, is some of the music that, you know, we're playing right now. So it's just been like a very long journey. But then even then, Stefan Harris got to be the dean of Manhattan School of Music Jazz Program by the end of my experience out there in Stockton, California. And I want to tell you, man, nobody knows about Stockton, bro. Like, it's just kind of like a forgotten spot in Cali. But, man, if anybody from Stockton is listening, shout out to everybody from Stockton. It's a slept-on city, man. But it's heart and culture and love out there. And it's crazy because the community does not have a lot of, like, funds. It doesn't have a lot of programming. Like, the college is the biggest thing in the town. And I won't say it's the safest town either. Like, I got, you know, I was roommates with this dude, Isaiah Collier from Chicago, really dope saxophonist. You know, he's making his strides out here in the world as well. And, man, we got pulled up on gunpoint 2 times while I was a freshman, 18 years old in college. So it's just like, you know, being 3,000 miles from home, I was kind of getting homesick, but also I'm falling in love with who I am. But I'm also in this kind of dangerous place that has a lot of, like, gang
stuff. And I'm not about any of that shit. So I don't know even know how that happened. Then I transferred to Manhattan School of Music because Stefan Harris was the dean there.
Moved to New York. It was lit, man. It was just like I really got to start working. Man, as soon as I got to New York, I stopped going to fucking class. Like, I wasn't going to no humanities, none of that shit. I was going to my private lessons. I was studying with this OG, Cecil Bridgewater, amazing trumpet player. I was, you know, just getting a chance to bring in my compositions to my small group. I'll never forget the musicians that I was going to school with at MSM. Rodney James from Brooklyn, BK's very own, Rocky Amer, Savannah Grace Harris, my sister, and Matt Malinowski and Hwan Soo Kang. I was able to workshop my compositions that I was writing at that moment with those folks. And I was even able to just like learn about how to write because they were bringing in so much stuff. So it's like, man, when I was in New York, I wasn't worried about going to class and shit, but I was just like learning as much as I could. And I started playing professionally while I was in New York, you know, started getting opportunities, random opportunities, you know, to play with big musicians, to travel. And then by the end of that school year, the dean had a fucking conversation, or not the dean, the president of the school had a conversation with me. She's like, hey, Brandon, you know you're on the full ride and shit, and you haven't been to humanity since fucking August or whatever. And it's like, May, we're going to have to take the scholarship away. So I'm like, damn, like, I'm not paying for college, and I never came to college to get my degree. I came here to meet people. I did what I needed to do. Then I got my first crib in Baltimore, 2018 May. Man, I'll never forget that date, man. I moved in 1127 St. Paul Street, East Biddle. Troy, I think he's outside smoking now. But Troy, one of my best friends and partner in this music shit, my keys player, man, he was living a block down from me, man. And that was the dude that I met in middle school. You know what I'm saying? We've been building since middle school. And once we knew that we were living one block from each other after I dropped out of college, it was like, fuck, this is perfect timing. Man, we locked in. And then that was like the first investments I really made to Upendo as soon as I moved back to Baltimore. That was 2018, man. It's 2024 now. And it's just been a journey, man.
Yeah. I know that you kind of like, as a multifaceted artist, like you're very clear about your identity as not just a trumpeter, but as a band leader, as a composer, as, you know, a multifaceted artist. And I wonder kind of like what that journey is like for you, kind of like shaping who you are as an artist. And like the moments where you have to push back against people just categorizing you as a trumpeter.
Yeah, you know, I'm so specific about the names and labels people put on me. But I'm trying to be more, I'm very sensitive, but I'm trying to be more open because it's like, man, it doesn't fucking matter. It's just a word, you know. You could call me whatever, you know what I'm saying? You could call me jazz trumpet player, but guess what? It's going to sound like how I want it to sound, you know? So I'm trying to get better with that. But, you know, again, like you were saying, yeah, I'm very super specific about what I'm being called. I don't want to put this shit into a genre, man. I don't. My shit sound like Baltimore. My shit sound like the struggle. And it's like, man, one thing that's like so big in the city of Baltimore, man, just all of our musicians, beauty in the struggle. You know what I'm saying? Like that's something that is... That's the genre of my music. You know, my life, my struggles, you know, even coming from my OG, Quincy Phillips, his life, his struggles, his successes, Mike, Troy, you know, all of this is pouring into what we have to say. And then also, I just want to say, like, man, ain't nobody playing like us. You know what I'm saying? We got this specific thing from Baltimore, and it's like, yeah, there is a specific language in Baltimore, but also me and my group, we've been together for the last 6-7 years, learning how to love each other, learning how to talk to each other, learning how to show up with each other, making mistakes together, having uncomfortable situations. And it's just like, man, like at this point, me and my band members, we just feel so comfortable
together in this space that we've made for each other. It's like, and that's why I'm like, man, you know, I want to show you my band, and I want them to talk to you, because it's like, yeah, my name is on this, and I invest a lot into this shit, but so does everybody else. You know what I'm saying? Of course, I'm the band leader or whatever, but man, I love Troy with my life. I love Mike with my life. I love Quincy with my life, and man, it wouldn't be anything without them. And honestly, man, I think the best way to describe my music is, number one, black music. That's something that's non-negotiable. It's black. It's coming from black struggle, black success. Another thing is social music. You know, this music is social. It's with the people. It's for the people. You know, and in another word to describe my music, I'll say, is healing music. When we wrote this music, in the beginning, when I first started writing some of this music, man, it was like, I was hearing these melodies in my mind. It's like trying to get on the piano, or might send it to Troy, or me and Troy might get up, make some chords to it, whatever. And then it's like hearing that shit in my mind over and over again. And I'm like, damn, this shit to begin with is to heal me and my band members. Like, it's like, man, I'm dealing with some of these problems, and this music is addressing these problems, these real life problems that I'm dealing with in life, whether those are physically, whether those are spiritually, we're all dealing with some shit. So that's what I'll say. This music was to heal me first and heal my band members. But after that, you know, after we put it out, or after, you know, we're about to play this show tonight in New York, it's like, man, what I've learned through hearing folks, you know, that have talked about me or came up to tell me how meaningful or spiritual a show was for them, I've noticed that, man, this shit ain't only healing for myself. It's healing the world, too. It can heal folks that listen to it.
Yeah. I appreciate that perspective on, like, genre and categorization. You know, you spoke a little bit about, like, you know, the moment you picked up a trumpet and kind of that journey. But I do wonder, like, thinking back to that time, like, what was it about when you started playing a trumpet, those first couple of years of you playing trumpet, like what struck you and inspired you? Because like, it's hard to get kids to practice their instrument, you know, like it's like it's something about you at that young age that you're like, there's this feels special and I need to follow this.
Man, you know what it was? I was in third grade, man. My teacher, shout out to Mr. Freeman, if you listen to this.
Yeah, Mr. Freeman.
Shout out to Leafwalk Elementary, man. East Baltimore history. I remember, you know, when I first started playing trumpet, man. Number one, I couldn't make a sound out of that motherfucker for 2 weeks. I wasn't able. They told me to buzz like a bee, whatever. I was like, I'm not getting it. But then I finally get it, right? And I wasn't able to rent the instrument until I could make a sound out of it. So I finally, I'm coming into the band room at 7 a.m. every morning before school just so I could try to attempt at making a sound so I could take this thing home. Finally did that. And then guess what? After that, every week we would have band rehearsal, 2 days a week? It's like B days, Tuesday and Thursday we had band rehearsal. I don't know what this was, man. I didn't even know what the feeling was at that moment, but after I really knew it, I would get butterflies like 5-10 minutes before fucking band rehearsal. Every day we had band rehearsal, I would get butterflies, like a nervousness, but excitement, literal butterflies. So then it was like drawing me to it. But then by the end of that year, just, you know, later down the line, I built, you know, my skills up. I was like, oh, that's why I was having that feeling.
Yeah.
This was like God. This was like kind of God sent, like your body tells you what you want to do.
Yeah,
if you're very excited about some shit, if you really, really love it, it ain't about, you know, all this other shit, all of this human made shit and all of this tangible shit. No, it's about you doing it, you know, and that's all it's about. So whatever, nothing could get in the way of that.
Yeah,
I knew that at a very early age, and my mom was just so supportive, man, and I'll let you know, just like the mentors that I've had in Baltimore, man, I want to give a big shout out to Craig Austin. We got the same birthday, actually, OG. Thel John Allen, one of my favorite trumpet players in the world. That's my OG.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We just got, it's a lot of folks that are in that Baltimore community, And that even though they've traveled the world, man, they bought a house in Baltimore. They've written in Baltimore, and they still there, and they're still a part of their community and still giving everything that they have.
Yeah.
You know, after traveling the world.
Yeah. I appreciate that, like, feeling of being like, it made me nervous. And I do feel like that's a thing where you think, if you think about the shit that you're passionate about or the shit that you want to follow in life, it's the shit that makes you nervous that you're still like, I'm going to do that. Like, if it makes you nervous and you're like, I don't really give a fuck, then, like, you're just not going to do it.
Yeah.
But if it makes you nervous and you're like, nah, I'm going to do it, you really give a fuck.
Yeah, no, it makes you nervous in a good way because it's, I think things make you nervous when you care about them a lot.
And yeah,
it's
yeah.
Like, man,
yeah.
It's, and then also, man, let's talk about our language that we built up together. It's like, yeah, we had this language. We know how to talk to each other. We have each other's musical love languages, and we know how to make space, and we know how to take chances. But all of this shit is in a moment. So why can't I? You know, it's like, of course I'd be a little bit nervous because all of this shit is in a moment. Man, we could go this way and then immediate left right there.
Yeah.
But we're all together. You know, so it's just like, man, what chances are we going to take tonight? What risks? How are we about to push it tonight?
Yeah,
it could be different every time. But the thing is, like, what I notice is, like, man, people come. Even if every concert is different for the rest of my life, it's like people come for a consistent feeling that they get when they see us.
Yeah,
because we're reaching for something.
Yeah,
it's not. You know, we're not just accepting what it is right now. No. We're always reaching for that next thing, and that's what it is musically, and that's what it is live, you know, and that's what it'll be on the album whenever that comes up.
Yeah, we'll get to that. I do want to ask, like, you know, obviously you're like attracted to the music at an early age, and you spoke to like your mom putting you in programs and having different mentors and stuff like that, and obviously right now you look at it and you like understand the weight of that legacy and that lineage. And I wonder, like, I guess, like, did you as a young student of the game, like, understand the weight of, like, the history and the lineage? Or at one point were you like, oh, like there's a rich cultural history here that I need to, like,
you know,
that I'm a part of and need to understand?
I saw it and I... It's like I saw it, but and I acknowledged it, but I didn't dive in deep until I was very curious myself. And this is a thing like that I think, you know, for the youth is like, man, I don't think you're ever going to dive in so deep into history that you're not curious about yourself. It doesn't matter if your professor is telling you, don't matter if your OG telling you,
right?
You're not going to do it unless you want to know. So what? Man, I'm about to give a big shout out to this guy. You know what I'm saying? I got to meet him a couple years back. But he was a big inspiration just in terms of like tracing back the lineage and getting me excited. Christian Scott, man. When I was 14 years old and I was going to Baltimore School for the Arts and I didn't have an opportunity to play jazz in my high school, so I just had Apple Music. I just had my headphones that I was listening to all the time. LA, and also Matt Stevens, man, amazing guitar player. I was just talking to him the other week. We were the other month we was at New York, we're in a jazz fest together. This record changed my life. LA, Angola, and the 13th Amendment. So me just hearing that in high school, and I was playing, man, I must have played that motherfucker 2,000 times. Like I'm responsible for some of that streaming money, goddamn it. But I played that joint so much, and I was like, man, like. And I wasn't hip to everybody back then. I got hip to more people, but that was kind of like my point of entry for curiosity. Like, okay, well, this motherfucker that's not too old, maybe only 10 years older than me, he really has his own sound. And like, shit, this shit sound mine. And it's like, he playing his shit, you know. And of course, maybe I don't, you know, feel the same way about him as I do now that I've learned more things, but I still love him. And it's just always like, that inspired me, the fact that he really had his own sound. And that's what inspires me about most of the people that I like. Man, your unique sound. I mean, there's so many motherfuckers out here that are just, you know, painting the same thing as Van Gogh or painting the same shit as whoever, you know. Nah, man, I like the uniqueness of it. That's what it's about, the specialness, the individuality, you know, just like in
that made me want to dive more into my own sound as well. But it was like I didn't necessarily know how to have my own sound. So it's like learning from somebody about like, man, this is how they formed their own sound. You know what I had to do? I saw, you know, I was like, I really like this Christian Scott shit, man. Who did he study with? Who was before him? And then I just went into a fucking, you know, hole, rabbit hole, like, and found out about all of these amazing trumpet players from New Orleans, found out about all of these other folks. And you know what? I think that's important, man. Like, you don't need to enter the shit at day one. You don't have to enter the shit at Buddy Bolden and Louis Armstrong. That does not have to be your point of entry. I just don't think that that's like, it's not going to be everybody's point of entry. Yeah, if that's your point of entry, that's fucking fine. You know what I'm saying? But, and you need to get there for sure. Right. And you need to get back to, you know, hymns and slave songs, all of that shit. But like, whatever your spark, it whatever sparks your mind. So Christian Scott, when I was 14 years old, he sparked my mind.
Yeah.
So I was like, that was my point of entry to getting back. And then, man, through high school, I learned about everybody. I was transcribing, listening to all these different records, you know. Shit, some of my favorite trumpet players are Freddie Hubbard, you know, Nicholas Payton, Booker Little, Woody Shaw. I really like fiery guys, you know. Lee Morgan, Thou John Allen, my OG.
It's just finding that point of entry and then you're in.
Yeah, that's all it is, finding a point of entry. Once you find that point of entry, nigga, we all here.
Yeah.
What's up?
You know, you mentioned a record, but I'm curious to kind of hear your perspective on kind of like music and your like musical practice as it relates to, I guess, industry. Cause like, I feel like you, you know, I understand that you're like, and as you've been talking about, like very focused on the energy that's being translated through the live show. And that live show is very much representative of who y'all are as players and the music that you're trying to represent. And you've been, you know, somewhat mysterious with the music that's out there on the internet. In a way that, like, your name is floating around, people are talking about you, and then, you know, you might catch the live set on YouTube or something like that. But but for people that listen to your music, they got to find you. And I wonder what the what your philosophy on that is and strategy kind of behind that right now.
Man, so again, when I came back to Baltimore, when I dropped out of college, got that first apartment, it was just like, man, let's just make the music. We had a monthly gig at Andy Music, this local venue in Baltimore. We played there like, what, 8-9 months, you know, that year, every month. And I was investing, bringing in some folks out of town, having a core band, building this shit up. But you know what, man? I don't even want to say blinded, but I've just been immersed in making music with my friends. That's it. I haven't been thinking about putting it out so that y'all can hear it.
Yeah.
At the same time, that's not the end all or be all. The end all or be all was the music that we made and us loving on each other, you know? Yeah. So it's like, of course, when we put out the record, it's going to click. Man, I got motherfuckers that tell me, yo, and guess what? A lot of my songs don't have names to them. A lot of that shit is untitled. Man, hella. I'm talking about 50, 60 songs with no names, bro. 50, 60 songs with no names. Guess what? My audience members say, oh, man, when you going to play that? And that's, again, it's like, that wasn't a fucking philosophy that I had. Oh, no name so that folks know the fucking melodies of my song. No, I didn't even know. I just didn't.
Yeah.
I'm still living through the song, and this music is so fucking alive that, like, and it's growing every time that we play it, and it's all in the moment. So it's like, I didn't know what name to put on it. You know, this shit is like representative of so much of my life and so much of my struggle and so much of my success. So, like, I need to live some more.
Yeah.
And that's what I felt like in a lot of the past years. Because, shit, man, we recorded an album 2019.
Yeah.
That the world isn't going to see. You know what I'm saying? But, like, I just needed to live some more. And, of course, COVID happened. And it's like, man, like, this last year and these past couple months, like, I'll say the past couple 6 months, it's like, man, we've really, like, and we're continuing to grow, continuing to put ourselves in uncomfortable positions. But more than anything, I'm like, man. And I don't, I, I have no doubt that this is what we were from the beginning. But I know for sure that we're undeniable. I think this year more than ever, you know, we've got the opportunity to play at a few jazz festivals at a few different clubs, and you know, making a plan for the rest of the year and just naturally expanding things. But you know what? When we naturally expand things, like we played in Ohio 2 times last year, and we also, you know, just played at a lot of different colleges, a lot of different festivals outside of Baltimore. And when you leave your hometown, you get to see the invisible impact that you wouldn't have gotten to see otherwise. So, yeah. Like, if I would have just stayed home, yeah, I mean, the impact would have been made in Berlin or in Cali or whatever, but I just wouldn't have seen it. So it's like, man, I went out there and played a show, and I talked to this brother after the show, young brother. He go to a college. I'm not even going to name his name or anything, but he was like, oh, bro, like, I'm playing your song in my senior recital.
That's crazy.
And that's just like, damn, like, at this point, we have repertoire.
Yeah, that's crazy.
You know, I was like, bro, I sent them the music and everything. I was like, yo, hit me up. Yeah. Hit me up. Yeah. Know, whatever I can do. And then even hearing from somebody else in Berlin, this dude that's going to college out there, he's like, bro, I love your music. It means so much to me. He did the same thing. He did it on, like, his master's recital. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, it's motherfuckers all over the world that are younger or older than me playing my music in serious institutions.
Yeah.
That's a thing. Like, I'm like, wow, that speaks to, nigga, ain't no fucking album out. So you had to listen to this shit 10 times on YouTube or Instagram just to learn that shit.
It's really wild. And it in the world, in like a world where music is available everywhere, it really like brings it back to like a different era.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, man, it's still spread, it's still traveling, even though it ain't on the, I don't got a TikTok, or I don't, yeah, my shit ain't on Apple Music, but it's like,
it's beautiful.
Yeah. You know, it is, you know, it's wherever. And but you know what the thing is? It's not about all of, it's not about the invisible impact. It's about the faith, you know, just having faith in what you're doing. Somebody's going to hear this. That's important. So we need to be really just having strong faith at all times, man. Strong faith at all times. You know, I like, shit, just even today, bro, we was about to get arrested. The train was held back a whole hour and 2 hours, whatever. And it's just like, man, these things are stressing me out and shit. But let me just chill out and have faith. Everything going to be good, you know. Yeah. And as long as we're as strong as our faith is. You know what I'm saying? Nothing is stronger than our faith. Should be stronger than our faith.
I feel you. Well, let's talk about the band a little bit, but you want to bring the band in here?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, let's bring them in.
Is everybody in there right now?
Yeah, yeah. We'll bring them in here, and we'll bring some chairs in. We are back. Brandon, if you want to just introduce the band and who's around you real quick.
Yes, sir. They can introduce themselves.
I'll pass the mic around.
Yes, sir. Cuffs. Nah, my name's Quincy Phillips.
What do you play? Say, you got
Quincy Phillips, drums, Upendo, cuffs.
You already know. I'm Mike Saunders. I play bass.
I'm Troy Long. I play piano and keys.
There you go. You know, as we were just talking about, this band and the live show is what has people talking and is what is taking the music around the world right now. And I wonder if you know, what is the process for you guys of putting a show together and of playing together in terms of, like, you know, where the arrangements are coming from, if everything you're playing is practiced, if you guys are improvising, like, how does the show come together?
I think Troy would.
I knew he was going to do that. I guess I'll speak more to when we're playing the music, like, during the show. It's a lot of trust, a lot of open-mindedness. Of course, we always come with, like, a set structure. Sometimes maybe not a set structure, but usually a set structure. But we want to leave space for it to go wherever from there. And I will say a lot of things get added. Like sometimes we'll be at a gig where we're playing trio or duo, and we might think of a line to repeat at the end of a song or in the intro or beginning. And we might be like, okay, well, now that's a part of the song. And that's part of why it's been so hard to record these joints, because they're always changing.
Yeah.
So just keeping that fluidity, I would say.
I know that, you know, all y'all in your own right probably play with a number of different bands and ensembles. What is it about Upendo and this crew that kind of stands out or is different for you?
For me, I would say Upendo, it's funny that it means love, because this is probably like the one gig I do that is all about the love. You know what I mean? It doesn't really matter the dollar amount, you know what I'm saying? There could be no dollar amount. You know, we travel everywhere. Hopefully we get to travel more, you know? But this is like this is all about the love for me. You know what I mean? That and getting to do it with friends, you know, family, for real.
It's about cuffs for me.
Okay.
No, I think Quincy has something to say about this too, because he plays, yeah, you know, around the world with other people.
Yeah, I know for me, you know, I've said this to the cats, you know, the compositions and the songs are so massive. I mean, they're like worlds within themselves. And I've never told Brandon this, but, you know, before Roy passed, I don't know how he saw a clip or anything, but he said, "Hey, man, who took my sound?" And he was talking about Brandon. He heard Brandon playing. And that's, you know, the music is so, it's rich. And, I mean, we trust each other. He's pulled the right cats in, and, we all trust one another, and the music just keeps getting bigger, 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 bigger. Now, we have had some meetings, and, we had to put the cuffs on some folk, but, you know, that's a family, you know what I mean? It's been amazing. I know it's been amazing for me, and I could tell it's been amazing for the other cats. So yeah, it's a joy, man.
You know, when you're like talking about that, is that kind of you? Is that people that don't understand it?
Nah.
People that you got to put the cuffs on.
I think it's more so, you know, you have to grow in a relationship. And I believe that's what we've all done. And so I trust them. So like when we had the, you know, little meeting, the cuff meeting, you know, they was like, "Nah, this, you know, try this." And, you know, and I'm thinking one thing in my mind, they thinking another thing, or, you know, so, you know, it's about, it's family and it's trust. And, you know, I take on I have the point of view of, look, man, I'm about the music. It ain't about me. You know what I mean? It's about the music. Long as the music don't suffer, I'm all with that. Even if that means I'm laying out or I'm playing a particular line, although sometimes I don't, you know, do what I'm supposed to do. But for the most part, you know, I'm about the music. So,
yeah. Hell yeah. You know, y'all have a lot going on right now. a lot of shows in the present, a lot of shows coming up. What is kind of on the vision board for y'all this year?
Man, I believe we're going to work on this record soon. You know, having some rehearsals and, you know, just getting all the songs together. Going into the studio pretty soon this year. We have some shows out of town booked, definitely hitting pretty much everywhere in the East Coast for sure by this summer. And just trying to expand that. So, you know, definitely going to hit some of the Midwest this year. And, you know, it's definitely a goal to get to, you know, West Coast as well, you know, this year. Just, trying to build it all up slow and surely, you know, very slow and surely. Like, we're definitely hitting Detroit this year, hitting Chicago, some other things. Building it up, and, you know, by the end of this year, we'll be in Europe. We'll be in, you know, all these other different places. It's going. I never been one of them folks, you know, to just try rush things. You know, it's like let's build up something in each city. You know, and you know, slowly but surely. You know.
Yeah. You know, at the end of all these interviews, we have artists introduce a song of theirs to play the episode out. Since you don't have a record, you can pick whatever you want. If there's a live composition or something.
Yeah, yeah. You know what? We just released a YouTube video. This is actually something that we recorded 2023 January, I think, or February. We all did this just like a live recording, some really dope content. But yeah, it's a full live performance of this song that we did. Me and Troy wrote this song together. I want to say at least 2 to 3 years ago, we were actually working on a film score, a really one of our longest film scores yet. And we kind of rearranged and recomposed this joint for the group. And I also want to, you know, say shout out to everybody else who was involved in that. My boy Neon June, he was doing the sound. My boy Josh Nee Smith was shooting that. So yeah, that's on our YouTube, and you know, you can hear the YouTube just like you can hear the Apple Music. So you should be able to go ahead and, you know, if you want to have just an audio sonic experience, close your eyes and it'll go to, you know, right the same way. You know what I'm saying? It'll be that experience. Yeah. Run our YouTube up for sure. Run our YouTube up.
What's the song called?
It's untitled. Untitled 50.
Do you want to?
It's straight on YouTube.
If you want to give us, like, to intro the song, like, I'm Brandon Woody, this is Upendo, and this is blank on Not 97.
Okay. I'm Brandon Woody. We are Upendo, and this is Untitled 50 by me and Troy Long on Not 97.
Thank you. We appreciate y'all.
Thank you. Thank you.